We are very pleased with your presence today, and we are very enthusiastic since it is our first defense thesis in international law. As chair of this examining board, I will read some official information about the procedure. The chair of the jury host and directs the defense. The chair will give the floor to the doctorate student for 20 minutes so he can present his doctorate research. Afterwards, the chair will give the floor to the members of the jury so they can make commentaries to the research and formulate follow-up questions. The doctorate student then will have up to 20 minutes to comment on the observations of each member of the jury. Subsequently, the chair will ask all the attendants to leave the room so the jury can have a private deliberation and take a decision, including whether to grant the distinction. The chair will finally resume the public audience and proceed to read the final act containing the decision. Point out that our task today is to make judgments agreeing with our particular logic about how it should be and how you should present a scientific work so as to qualify as a doctoral thesis. The defense of the doctoral thesis constitutes a fundamental part of the academic process, and the purpose today is to confirm the competence of the doctoral students. If my colleagues of the board agree, we will start hearing Professor Makanem Beyge-Moise's remarks, then Professor Soufiane Droubi, and I will finally take the floor for some concluding remarks and observations. But before asking Professor Makanem Beyge, I would like to invite the candidate to give an overview of the research on which your thesis is based.
Good afternoon, everyone. Dear Professor Julio Andres San Pedro Arrula, Dean of the Faculty of Judicial Sciences of Pontificia Universidad Javeriana. Dear Professor Vanessa Swelcock, Director of the Doctorate Program in Judicial Sciences. Dear Professors Soufiane Droubi from the University of Sao Paulo and the University of Manchester, Professor Makan Moïse Mbenge, Professor of the University of Geneva, and Professor Carolina Olarte Pacares from Pontificia Universidad Javeriana, or honorable members of the jury. Dear Professors Jean Dapremont, also my salutation to Professor Rafael Prieto San Juan, who is not here, but I want to send him my regards, director, supervisors of this doctorate thesis. Dear other professors of the faculty, colleagues, dear family members, and friends. It is my highest privilege and honor to be here in front of such an honorable audience in order to defend the doctoral research that I have been carrying out for the past 5 years. It has not only been the most enriching academic experience of my life, but it has been also a tremendous opportunity to enjoy the care and support from many people to whom I owe unmeasurable appreciation. Before presenting my research, I would appreciate so much if the honorable jury allows me to address a few words in Spanish in order to publicly thank my family, members, and friends for being part of such an important night. Thank you so much. Bueno, contando con el beneplácito del jurado, quisiera primeramente dar gracias a Dios por darme la vida y la oportunidad de comparecer a este importantísimo evento académico. Deseo que esta instancia profesional no solo se manifieste en una distinción personal, sino que pueda pragmatizarse en una contribución a la sociedad a través del derecho internacional como un agente de paz. Pero también quiero agradecer pues, a mi esposa por su amor, su apoyo incondicional en estos años, algunos momentos difíciles, otros muy felices, pero aquí estamos. Muchas gracias. Asimismo, un especial agradecimiento a mis padres, a mi hermano, a mi suegra, a mi tía, a todos los familiares, a mi prima, todos los amigos, estudiantes, pupilos, colegas que se encuentran en este momento acompañándome, de verdad, muchas gracias. So coming back to my speech in English, I cannot start before explicitly thanking my thesis supervisors, Professor Jean Dapremont and Professor Rafael Prieto San Juan, because their guidance has turned out to be fundamental for the development of the research. Thank you, John, very much for giving me the privilege of being supervised by you. I feel extremely and undeservedly honored to have your name and Rafael's name in my manuscript. It's my complete privilege. I wish also to thank Professor Vanessa for giving me all her support, Professor Julian de San Pedro, who also was former director of the program, Father Alvarez, who isn't here, but I also want to express him my gratitude as founding director of the program. My gratitude to all the professors of the program. I have to express my gratitude to Professor Carolina Larte, who commented early versions of the document and gave me very useful advice in different regards, as well as Professors Carlos Andres Uribe, Jorge Gonzalez, René Urueña from Los Andes, Jorge Viñuales from Cambridge, Duncan French from the University of Lincoln, with whom I had the privilege to discuss a few parts of the research. So all my gratitude to them, and my thankfulness also to the members of the jurors who came here tonight, and feel extremely honored. I'm coming to my research. So I will divide my presentation in seven parts. As you can see in some slides I will be showing, I already shared the printed version with the jury. Firstly, I want to speak about the title, then I will speak why did I choose this topic. I will comment on the legal problem that is behind my whole research in order to explain the main claim of my thesis. So I can also comment on how did I do this research, the methodology and structure, and finally come up with some conclusions. So which are those seven steps? Initially, the title. The title is Customary International Law as an Argumentative Framework, an Alternative Theoretical Approach in International Environmental Law. So the thesis is essentially a theoretical enterprise, which discusses the concept of customary law as a source of international law and proposes a specific perspective that overcomes the difficulties of the ambiguity of traditional perspectives. Although my thesis has a particular emphasis in the case of international law, environmental law, it is definitely not a thesis about international environmental law. However, I chose this field because it is undoubtedly the most composed field of international law where the most critical areas of the theory can be tested, such as the possibility of having customary law even despite the lack of practice. So, whereas the research proposes a new theoretical approach for the identification of customary international law, it finally illustrates it in the field of international environmental law. But secondly, why did I choose this topic? Back in 1937 at the Hague Academy of International Law, Professor Lauterbach once affirmed that la théorie des sols c'est la base du droit international. I believe that such an assertion remains up to date. International law is what the sources say it is, because it is this doctrine which allows to distinguish law from other normative systems. More particularly, and within the doctrine of the sources and in more specific discussions, it becomes absolutely relevant to auscultate and discuss the formal criteria for the distinction between law and non-law. And on that regard, of course, the findings of Professor Dapremont have been very influential at this initial stage of the research. Professor Dapremont, in his monograph on the sources, says that the ascertainment, and I am quoting him, of international legal rules until recently remained a central concern of the international legal scholarship, which has long elevated the elaboration of criteria for the identification of law through the theory of the sources into one of its paramount tasks. Customary international law, as one of the sources of international law, therefore requires too a continuing and rejuvenating formalism that provides and explains a criteria allowing law interpreters to identify law, providing this way with formalism to a source which is informal in nature. But what is the problem? And I'm going to the third point of my presentation. So, however, due to its non-written nature, customary international law comes with problematic features that are not suffered by a more resolved source like treaties, and even though we already discussed this morning that treaties have very issues themselves. However, thus the original conceptual problem of customary international law is precisely the lack of certain, hopefully, written criteria defining it, not only useful for the ascertaining of international law in abstracto, but for the content determination of customary rules in concreto, in a day-to-day practice of international law. So for those reasons, it is not rare to find assertions according to which customary international law is obsolete, that it is vanishing, or as Patrick Kelly has famously established, or so that is nowadays we are witnessing its decay. And most of such conclusions are the product of the lack of consistent and a unified theory of customary international law. Such problematic scenario probably influenced Jiménez de Arechaga's famous comment when he spoke about the amorphous but formidably jellyfish of customary international law. So indeed, the theory of customary international law needs to be addressed. The whole research is addressed to a main question, which is the following, I guess that might be the third point. Does customary international law provide a reliable yardstick to distinguish between law and non-law? That general question is followed by follow-up questions such as, how is customary international law identified in contemporary international law? Or whether there is an undoubted theoretical approach to customary international law? On the contrary, is there a dominant understanding of customary international law, and so on and so forth? So, the main claim of my thesis, and I think I am here already touching the most important part of my presentation. So, this research asserts that customary international law does indeed provide a reliable yardstick to distinguish law between non-law. However, such distinctive criteria should not be looked upon from a traditional rule-based approach to international law, but rather from an alternative social perspective which conceives international law as a social science and international law as a social product, more precisely as a social construct. We international lawyers have been taught that customary international law is a product of practice and opinion juris. However, I don't believe that such fairy tale is entirely true, and that's why I'm building this argument. So therefore, the main claim, the linchpin of my thesis is that customary international law is an argumentative framework limited by theoretical tensions produced, formulated, and interpreted by the community of international lawyers practicing international law. So this thesis also contends that the content determination of customary international law in any situation is determined by an argumentative framework that operates within the limits of theoretical tensions developed by the argumentative legal community. Meanwhile, this argumentative framework is drawn or established through technical international language and the most fundamental international legal doctrinal developments. In simple words, I propose that customary international law is the product of successful argumentative campaigns. On the other hand, the thesis also sustains that it is possible to identify the source of the source, that means the source of international customary international law. And contrary to what the mainstream doctrine argues, the source of customary international law is not another rule. But I consider that the source is rather the practice of the community of international lawyers. So while the traditional doctrine focuses also in the practice of states, and for example, the main perspective of the current work carried out within the International Law Commission, however, I personally have never seen a state walking on the streets, or arguing before a court, or giving a speech at the UN. What I have rather seen is just people, men and women, international lawyers who act on behalf of states and other international subjects. So let me illustrate in a more simpler way how I think that customary international law finally emerges. After recognizing a need or simply an interest, an international lawyer plants a seed containing the origin of an argumentative campaign for a customary rule to emerge. That seed can be planted either in a speech before the United Nations General Assembly, in a memorial before an international tribunal, at some oral proceeding, or even through a research book or an academic paper. Meanwhile, the idea of having such rule as customary international law should be subsequently supported by other international lawyers acting on behalf of different subjects of international law, although there is not a rate of how less or how much support is needed. What is required is that it is considered that the rule has been argumentatively supported. In this argumentative process, as in any other, there are of course more influential arguments than others, both for the emergence of the rule or against it. So the rule might be more rapidly accepted if very influential lawyers representing influential international subjects do not oppose the rule. Like, let's say, those lawyers that work as judges of the International Court of Justice, or those other representing very well-known or very well-received international organizations. Therefore, a customary rule is finally considered existent after it has trespassed the required argumentative threshold, which is socially established and assessed by international lawyers working in the field. This explains why it is very, very rare to find a customary rule that is accompanied by a motivation containing the alleged practice and opinion juris that we were taught of in the classrooms of law faculties. It is not a mystery, for instance, that the ICJ asserts customary rules without demonstrating any of the elements that they themselves claim to be part of a recipe or a concept of customary international law. And this is also why a field like international environmental law has been developed through customary rules that have emerged even against practice. Otherwise, we would have embarrassing rules like the obligation to cause transboundary harm or the duty to carry out activities whose consequences will result harmful for the environment. Now, although I consider that customary international law should be theorized from a social perspective, it should be reiterated that it does not mean that customary law can emerge wherever, whenever, and however. And that is why I propose that customary international law is an argumentative framework and not only a series of disorderly presented arguments. So this thesis suggests that this framework has at least three recognizable limits. So it's not unlimited. The framework is not unlimited. The first limit is substantive. Not every argument is accepted, but it should be located within the range that exists between theoretical tensions that have been developed by the community of international lawyers. The second limit is formal, and that is why I have devoted some parts of the document to depict customary international law's argumentative technique, which includes, among others, the use of the technical language as the support through the international legal doctrine that we have today, which expertise is exclusively left to international lawyers. So argumentative campaigns aiming to position a customary rule can only be proposed through the language and the doctrine developed by international law. So it's not arbitrary. And the third limit is constituted by the kind of people or the type of people that can take part in such argumentative campaigns. And this is linked with the source of customary international law, which is the community of international lawyers. So not only a person has to be an international lawyer, formally recognized as such, but it has to demonstrate to be absolutely trained in all the expertise that characterizes international lawyers. Furthermore, it has to act usually on behalf of recognized subjects like a state, an international organization, an influential NGO, or even a prestigious academic institution. Thus, only after fulfilling all such requisites, an international lawyer can be heard in an argumentative campaign. For instance, I believe that if the community of international lawyers eventually validate me today as a doctor in juridical sciences through the voice of the jury here representing it, I may find eventually myself starting a way towards becoming one of those lawyers whose voice is heard in the said international community of international lawyers. So customary international law is not the sum of practice and opinion juries as we were taught in our law faculties, but rather this argumentative framework established by a community of international lawyers. In the final part of the thesis, I spent some time making an illustration of this perspective in the field of international environmental law. So that's essentially the main claim. I'm gonna just spend a few more minutes just depicting how did I do it and what's essentially the final conclusion. So I did it methodologically through the read and the analysis of international doctrine. Of course, I couldn't read and comment the whole range and bunch of international doctrine that has been written as regards customary international law, but I tried to select the most influential literature. How did I do it? Essentially by assessing which were the most quoted international legal doctrine, or at least the most influential. However, of course, it's an enormous task trying to cover it all. From that perspective, and after analyzing international legal doctrine, I present this main claim of customary international law as an argumentative framework through two main parts, which structurally are very simple. The first part depicts the problematic scenario behind customary international law. So it grasps what has been said regarding customary international law, and it proposes our own structures and our own taxonomies or categorizations in order to present the doctrinal developments regarding customary international law. The final words of part one are devoted to demonstrate that, as such, there is ambiguity as regards the theory of customary international law, and that this mainstream approach is not entirely working. Whereas in the second part is where I propose that customary international law is an argumentative framework. So after recalling the inadequacy of a rule-based perspective to customary international law and the usefulness of a social perspective, which can conceive customary international law as a social construct. So the final chapter illustrates different theoretical contributions that I have been making in the previous chapters in the field of international environmental law. So to that end, the final chapter not only demonstrates the existence and importance of customary international environmental law, but how it has developed even against the traditional perspectives, but it also illustrates the existence of the theoretical tensions and how is it argumentatively built. It should be highlighted that as a theoretical painter, so it was essentially, the thesis was essentially produced through discussions and conversations between the different legal developments. For instance, I have to acknowledge that whereas Professor Dacrimon has developed the need to distinguish between the processes of content determination and law ascertainment in the theory of the sources as a whole, I allowed myself to apply and explain such distinction in the theory of customary international law. Likewise, also a social approach to international law as a whole can be found in the work of critical legal scholars, international legal constructivists, and neo-positivists. Inter alia, I used such developments and applied them to the theory of customary international law. In this regard, although this work was very influential, however, while it speaks about the warfare of international law and how is international law rather an argumentative technique, as Koskimiemi famously asserted it in the Max Planck Encyclopedia, I tried to develop the argument in the theory of customary international law. So, which are the conclusions? All in all, I not only conclude that customary international law is rather an argumentative framework established by the community of international lawyers, but I am convinced that we are not witnessing the twilight of customary international law, as a well-known article would call it, Patrick Kelly's. On the contrary, we are witnessing the twilight of the traditional rule-based approach to customary international law and not of customary international law itself. However, it only needs to be approached differently from a social perspective. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Merci, Madame la Présidente, Dean San Pedro, respected Dean San Pedro, Director, Professor Vanessa Koch, dear colleagues, dear members of the jury, dear family members, good evening to everybody. I'm very pleased and honored to be part of this PhD Defense Commission. Not only because I'm happy to be back in Bogota. I have my first experience with this great country a few months ago when I was invited to teach at La Sabana. So I'm very happy to be back in this great academic institution that I've heard about several times through my very good friend Professor Jean Dacremont, but I've never had the chance to visit. So I'm very happy to be here, and I thank you for the invitation and the honor that you have given me. The second reason which makes me happy to be here is that, you know, it's not always frequent in our academic life to have the chance to sit in PhD defense of such high quality, and to have the chance to really engage into deep academic discussion and debate with a candidate like Fabian. And I have to say, and this is a personal touch maybe, I'm from the developing world. I'm from a little country in West Africa called Senegal. So as you, as a Colombian, I'm from the developing world. And it makes me very happy and proud when I see today that there are new voices in international law that are arising, and voices that are coming from the developing world. It makes me very happy. It gives us a lot of optimism for the future. You know, I teach and I live in Geneva, and quite often I have the chance to have dinner with certain very big names of international law, and in particular certain members of the International Law Commission, which is very relevant to your PhD. And quite often I have to say that I'm a bit frustrated when I sit with these people, and the only names that they mention as being those who contribute mostly are people from the Western world. And I think that this problem is due to the fact that for a long time we haven't had a great generation of international lawyers in the developing world, but now things are changing. And things are changing, so it means that people, international lawyers from the developing world, will be able to contribute as much as anybody else to the development of international law, but also to the codification of customary international law. And I'm very much convinced, Fabian, that you will be part of this new elite and generation of international lawyers from the developing world that will contribute to the identification and determination of customary international law. So all that to say that I was very pleased reading your work. I have to congratulate you for all the efforts you have put in this work. One of your PhD supervisors was saying in his speech that this was a very ambitious work, and it is true that it is ambitious. And when we read this work, we see that you have really did your best to tackle the challenge. You have done your best. To come with the best outcome you could come up with in terms of research. So I wanted to congratulate you for that. So for that, I wanted also to congratulate your law school for all the support, but also your supervisors for the excellent supervision of this work. So my personal view is that if you have the chance to work a bit more on this product to improve it, I think that it can lead to a very good publication, and I think also that it can lead to a work that would truly contribute to customary international law, and in particular in the international environmental law field, because I was talking about vacuum this morning, so allow me to use again the word vacuum this afternoon. There is a vacuum in terms of thinking and research regarding the process of formation of customary international law in the field of environmental protection. I will come back on the notion of customary international environmental law later. I'm not very sure I agree with that notion that you use in your PhD, but definitely there is a gap to be filled with respect to the thinking and the doctrine regarding customary international law in the field of environmental protection. Now, if you allow me, I would like to engage into a more critical discussion. That is the purpose of every PhD defense, to engage into critical discussion, into critical analysis. And for that, I would like us to have an interactive, Madame la Présidente, if you allow that, I would like us to have an interactive conversation. My remarks, as you will see, are long remarks, but I think that only a work of good quality triggers long remarks. If a work is not of good quality, then of course you have very brief remarks, very brief comments. So I want here everybody to understand that all my remarks, my comments here, are just a response to the quality of the work and to all the thoughts that have arisen in my mind while reading your work. So if you allow me, I would like first to address what I would call remarks of form, methodological remarks. I'm from the French law school system, as you know, and we are very attached to form. We sometimes even believe that form is more important than substance. Maybe it's good, maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong, but that's how we are. As we say, we are all a bit formatted in a system, and my format is the French system. So I have mainly five remarks regarding the form of your work. My very first remark, reading your work, was the presence of too many repetitions. Too many repetitions. It's very interesting, when we read you, we see that you want to convince yourself. You want to convince yourself of the legitimacy of what you're going to develop. So you keep on repeating, turning around, you know, stressing the same idea. And sometimes we just want to say, you know, go, Fabien, go, go. You know, it's the Copa America right now. So allow me to use a footballistic metaphor. So sometimes we just want to tell you, go, Fabien, you know, yes, we know. We know that you do not agree with this. Go ahead. Go ahead. And sometimes I have to say that this has rendered the reading of your PhD a bit heavy. And a bit unpleasant, because we for sometimes, I noted, sometimes for like 15, 20 pages, you turn around the same idea. And the question is whether you want to convince us or to convince yourself. Because personally, in many cases, two or three sentences were enough for me to be convinced. So I was wondering, reading, I was like, but what, is he really convinced of what he's claiming in this PhD? So also, why would he need 20 pages to say something that he could say in one page? So this was a first remark of form. Another second remark, usually when I sit in PhD defense, I don't like to address that issue, the issue of typos. I don't like to address it, because in every PhD work, there are typos, there are mistakes, spelling mistakes, and it's normal, so usually I do not. But in the particular context of this of your thesis, I feel obliged. I feel obliged to emphasize that there are too many typos. That there are too many typos, which once again do not question the quality of the work, but they question the serious character of what you've been doing. And we all know here that you are serious. But when you have so many typos, when you have so many sentences that are not complete or with problems of verbs and so on, this affects the quality of the work. And I just want to show one example that at page 131, to show how sometimes this type of typos can really question, you know, the serious nature of your work. At page 131, sorry, it takes me time to get there, but I'm there. You have a paragraph where you're talking about a Mr. We don't know if it's Mr. Chen or Mr. Chang or Mr. Chung, because in the footnote it's Mr. Chung, then in the first line it's Mr. Chen, then it's Mr. Chang. So we don't know. We don't know if you're talking about John Chung, Bin Cheng, Samuel Chen. It's problematic. It's very problematic. And I could give as examples. You have another part of your PhD where you're discussing the shrimp turtles case before the WTO appellate body. And you keep on saying the panel. You keep on saying the panel. I mean, if it's once, we say, okay, it's a lapsus. But when it's like 10 times, you're referring to a case before the WTO appellate body, and you keep on saying the panel, then it questions your, how do you say that, your control of this thing. And as you know, you said it yourself, international law is governed by codes. You know, to be part of the community of international lawyers, you have to respect certain codes. And confusing the WTO panel and the WTO appellate body is very problematic in my humble view. So maybe these things are due to the fact that you had maybe to conclude a bit fast this thesis, so maybe you did not have time to reread yourself. I might understand that, but I really invite you, when you rework on this, to be careful on every single word you use, because these are very important aspects. Then last aspect of methodology. I'm not addressing the list of abbreviations, no? Because there I think that it was a very, you know, wide selection of yours. I don't know, for instance, why we have TBT, the technical barrier technical barriers to trade agreement, and not SPS. So I don't know, but I don't want to go there. But I would like to stress to raise the issue of the bibliography selection. The bibliography selection. In your speech earlier, you told us that, well, you decided to not to read everybody, not to refer to everybody, and you decided just to refer to those people you believe are the most respected or quoted authors or scholars in this field. For me, I have a problem with this. I find that the justification you give to the selection of your bibliography is a bit too easy. It's a bit too shaky. Because at the end of the day, a PhD work is first and foremost research. It is not up to the PhD candidate to decide who's right and who's wrong in the business. It is not up to a PhD candidate to decide who are the scholars that deserve to be quoted in a work and the scholars which would do not deserve to be quoted in a work. I mean, I can understand that you say, okay, I'm not going to look at the Spanish doctrine, I'm not going to look at the French doctrine or at the German doctrine because maybe you are more familiar with English. I'm always fine that people do not refer to the French doctrine or the German doctrine, even if I find that it's a big mistake in international law, because many of the theories that today in the Anglophone world they claim to be new theories were already being written about, believe me, 20 or 30 years ago. So it's quite often a mistake not to look at German or French doctrine. But anyways, I can accept that you do not look at the old French or German doctrine. But when it comes to the English Anglophone doctrine, I think it's not correct in terms of methodology that you decide personally who are the people who deserve. Because at the end of the day, this is a research work. So research means you have exhausted, not local remedies, but research. And this is what proves that you have contemplated as much options, ideas and approaches possible before stating something or before affirming something. So this is what I wanted to say in terms of methodological remarks. And this brings me to my second category of remarks, Madame la Présidente, which I would call philosophical or intellectual remarks. And this is deriving a bit from my previous remark. I have to say that there was a taste of uncomfort reading your PhD. There was a taste of uncomfort. The main reason for that is that 80% of your PhD is inspired by one person who happens to be your PhD supervisor and who happens to be, you know, one international lawyers among us international lawyers, and who happens to be one thinker among other thinkers, and who happens to be one theorist of customary law among other theorists of customary international law. And I think that whoever, and this is not personal, no? But this is not personal at all. Professor Jean d'Apremont, in certain contexts, we even call each other brothers. So it's not at all a personal thing. I'm just telling you that with respect to what I wish you in the future, that you have this work being published. Whoever serious would read this would have a problem with your work. In any serious publishing house, if you deliver something like this, you would have a problem. Because intellectually, it is not possible that a PhD work is based on one author mainly. Because the reason is not the fact that that author is omnipresent. The problem is that you are yourself questioning the added value of your PhD. You see what I mean? A PhD is about the added value. What we expect you is to say, okay, there was this person or this person that have thought about it, and I have come now and add a new layer. So when most of the PhD is about quoting somebody else, then your reader would ask himself or herself, yeah, but what is the added value of this? Why do we need somebody to do a PhD to repeat what Jean d'Apremont or Jean, I don't know who, has said? Why would you do a PhD for that? Then in that case, let me just go and read Professor Jean d'Apremont. Maybe it's easier for me. You see what I mean? So I think it's very important to have that in mind. And this brings me to what I call the paradox. And it's still the philosophical issue. This brings me to what I call the paradox of this PhD. All this PhD is based on the idea according to which there is a dominant. There is a dominant understanding of customary international law. This is what you are criticizing from the outset. But you know, what you do in your PhD is replacing one dominant understanding by another dominant understanding. That's what you're doing. What you're criticizing at the beginning, that let's get rid of any dominant understanding. When I read it, I'm like, okay, but it's just replacing one dominant understanding by another dominant understanding by people you believe are right with respect to their analysis of customary international law. The same for the epistemic community. You say, yes, it's all a community of lawyers, it's a group of people, a club of people that are the ones telling us what is customary international law. But you are yourself legitimizing, do you say that? In English, sorry. You are yourself legitimizing that community which should be the one. You know, sometimes I don't want to do psychoanalysis. I never did. But there is one, I don't remember the page in your work, but page 229, no? At page 229 of your work, and this is for me an unconscious, you know, revelation of how you are yourself the promoter of that, you know, epistemic community. Page 229, you talk about some lawyers that were involved in cases before the ICJ. So when you take the Gafshikomo Najimaos, you respect the alphabetical order, because the alphabetical order allows you to give hierarchy to those people who you believe are the most important. So you start Crawford, Dupuy, Kiss, and Sands. Great. You respect alphabetical order, nobody's going to criticize it. But then when you talk about Pulp Mills, you don't talk with Boisson de Chazon, which is B. You start with Pelle, and then Sands, and then Cohen, and then Boisson de Chazon. This, in my view, is an exemplification of how yourself, you are legitimizing this community. You know, why wouldn't you start with Boisson de Chazon when you talk about pundits? Let's respect the alphabetical order. They were all counsels and advocates in the same case. So why should we start with Pundit? Just a philosophical remark. But now I would like to interact a bit with you, still at that philosophical level, and come back on Professor Jean d'Asplemont theories. And I would like to provoke you there. You see, you know Socrates. Socrates, he was saying that if you want to accede to philosophy, you need to kill the father. I'm not asking you to kill your father here. I'm sorry. We talk about spiritual. We talk about spiritual fathers here. I believe that if you want to accede to legal wisdom, you also need to kill your father. I killed my mother for my PhD. He killed his father. You can ask him. I would like you now to give you the chance to kill him. I would like you to tell us, what do you think, why do you think some people in this international community of lawyers, or in that community of international lawyers, do not read or even refer to Professor Dasperma when they discuss custom? I would like you to tell us first, why do you think they don't read him and they don't refer to him? Second, I would like you to tell us what are the flaws, the limits, and the weaknesses in Professor Jean Dasperma's theory of custom, or theory of the decay of custom. And third, I would like you to tell us what is your added value by comparison to what he has been doing for the few years with respect to customary law. You have the floor.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Makram, for such enriching comments. On the contrary, I feel honored because I actually realize that you have read the whole manuscript and I'm taking note of all your suggestions. So I'm just reacting to your specific questions. So, if I am not right, you are suggesting that you are asking me why do I think Professor Dacremont has not been quoted and used by people working on the theory of customary interaction?
By some. Yes, some.
Okay, by some. Okay, some, that makes the, yeah, the thing a bit different.
Yeah.
Because actually, on that regard, you know, for instance, I was very excited when I read Professor Crawford's speech at the International Law Association and how he used Professor Dacremont's ideas to develop his speech regarding the new theory of customary international law. And I also reckon that some of his distinctions between the processes of content determination and law ascertainment were acknowledged indeed by Sir Michael Wood, if I am not wrong. This kind of thinking is, of course, being heard. Of course, it's not the voice of the majority, but in any case, is still being heard. But if you ask me why I think like other people and the mainstream doctrine doesn't hear to such kind of arguments, is because this kind of thinking may just terminate the formalism and the lives of the diplomats and the people who live from this. Because they are really, you know, they have like a cult to formalism. They have a cult to rephrasing and repeating the formal yardsticks, which I have called probably and respectfully the fairy tale of customary international law. So once you change the paradigm and you start saying like, okay, Hart was wrong in this regard, there are no primary rules, secondary rules, and a secondary rule establishing a formula, and that's why I've been calling also the idea of, I'm building the idea of a recipe, because I also try to do it in a sarcastic manner. They really wish, they really want to have a recipe of customary international law, because I believe, and that's my personal view, I believe they have a cult to formalism. They feel safe when they have a clause, when they have a written clause, when they have a secondary, in Hart's term, rule saying precisely what is supposed to regulate customary international law. But once you change the paradigm and you say, okay, let's look this phenomenon from a different perspective, of course I think they all start to become shaky, because then the traditional formalism, the traditional schemes that have been working on the field, they start to fail. And that's why I personally think that such kind of perspectives are sometimes not very well received, particularly by an earlier generation of international lawyers of what you are. They sometimes feel disrespected because you know, this new generation is kind of changing the perspective, and it's changing the foundations, the theoretical foundations in which they rested their argument. And of course they are happy to quote Article 38(1)(b) clause that customary international law as evidence of practice accepted as law, even though it doesn't mean anything. So I think that's the real reason. But if you ask me, my my view, I might be right, I might be wrong, but my view is that even a few people from that generation, like Professor Crawford, like Sir Arthur Wood, they are willing to hear to such new perspectives. Of course, I don't think they are ready to pay the price, you know, to change everything. I am sure that such perspective will not be probably received within the work of the International Law Commission, because of course they want to stick to the rules, to stick to the state perspective of customary international law and the binary. Actually, that was one of the first conclusions that they achieved at the International Law Commission, if I am not wrong. And even worse, you know, I was surprised that in the very past meeting, because I've been following the International Law Commission, it's interesting that they were promoting and proposing the idea of changing the format of conclusions, which was more open, you know, to such kind of discourse. And some states are suggesting, oh, come on, let's go back to guidelines. I think it's because of the same sort of discussion that we were having this morning, because it just gives you, I mean, it gives that generation in power, in the scholarly power, a sense of security, a sense that things are working well. And I think it's like the last sequel of traditional doctrine on international law. So I think that's the reason.
Can you just give us one flaw of his theory, one?
On floor,
yeah, something that is
no. I disagree with a few things. For instance,
yes.
I mean, this is a bit embarrassing. I was
embarrassing.
But for instance, there is one thing in which we always disagree, and he has never been happy with that. He built this. He promoted and sold the importance of distinguishing between the two processes of content determination and law ascertainment. But I think Professor Dacremon himself claims that such theoretical development is completely useless in the theory of customary international law. And we have been always arguing about this. And sometimes I was more a believer of himself than he was himself, you know, because I said, I think this distinction is useful for the understanding of customary international law. But Professor Dacremon, he thinks that customary international law is still an informal source, that it cannot be formalized or explained in such a way. And he always asserts that this distinction is not applicable to customary international law. And I was always, you know, going against it. And I said, no, this is possible. This really explains something within the theory of customary international law, because that's my own personal view, and that's part of one of my own developments, is that I try to apply such distinction in the theory of customary international law. And that's when I said that, whereas the process of content determination, which is the identification of a law in concreto, can be determined by this argumentative framework. The source of the source of the legal ascertainment of the source is the practice of the community of international lawyer. Whereas Professor Dacremon would be only just one phenomenon. He always repeatedly affirmed that those two processes are merged, and I would say no, they are not merged. They can be identified, you know, in terms, or they can be identified in terms of customary international law for the sake of theoretical explanation. Although I repeatedly suggest that this distinction cannot be seen in a real situation, but it can be distinguished for the sake of theoretical understanding. Like, furthermore, we were having discussions, for instance, about his very influential work on the this book on the sources, the formalism of the sources of international law. And I have been always disagreeing respectfully how the book always gives an idea that you are resuscitating, you know, taking back from the dead formalism. Mm-hmm. But at the end, the argument goes into the social arena. And then he develops the argument, the social argument, in following papers. So sometimes we have been discussing about this, I think that it should have been just when wrote of an argument, and although I do not pretend to evaluate or criticize or
to make such an embarrassment of myself, you know, with Professor Dacrimon. I have always thought that it is possible to link the two arguments together. And I think that's one thing in which I was always disagreeing with him, and I came with my idea, I stick to it, and I developed this social perspective. On that regard, if you allow me, Professor Menke, I think that, in fact, and I always say it so, that the work of Professor Dacrimon has been influential to my thinking, because I really buy it. Some parts I think is what he's doing is important at this time, because he's making a shift in the paradigm of an earlier generation, and he's opening the door to a new generation to which I belong. But I of course make an emphasis on him, but that's probably of course my mistake, because the manuscript doesn't present it that way. But of course I'm always saying that this is not only his ideas. I mean, Koskinen's ideas, David Kennedy's ideas, Clower's ideas.
Yeah, but if I can just say something, one part of your PhD is about international environmental law.
It is.
I mean, I think that even Professor Jean Dacrimon himself wouldn't call himself an international environmental lawyer. So when we read the part on international environmental law, we believe that, okay, now we are done with the general discussion about custom. We're going to see maybe new authors. And suddenly, we come back again into Jean Dacrimon. And once again, I don't have any personal problem with you referring to him. But there are some very fundamental authors, for instance, in international environmental law, who do not appear in this PhD, and who have been really building, you know, the theory of international environmental law. I can concede that for the theory of customary international law, you hide behind your spiritual father. But for the theory of international environmental law, there are some big names, very important names, who have also published in English, who do not appear there. And this can be problematic for somebody from the outside who would read your PhD if one day you want to publish it. So you need to be careful on that. I'm not going to ask you to tell me what is the added value of your thesis, because I heard it already implicitly when you were discussing the flows. I would like Madame La Présidente now to finish with my third category of remarks, substantive remarks. So remarks regarding the substance of your work. I mean, this is once again a very excellent piece of thinking and of research. And I can say that every single sentence that I was reading, I was stopping to say, okay, it would make me think. Not necessarily that I would agree or disagree, but it would make me think. And I think this is what a PhD is about: provoking reflection, provoking thinking, and you have really succeeded in doing that, Fadna. But let me come to certain substantive remarks. First of all, your old ID, which is all over the PhD, but which is of course influenced by one of your supervisors, the old ID that there is a dominant understanding of customary international law. I'm sorry, I think this is a fantasy. You know, you start your work by telling us that the PCIJ and the ICJ have been the vehicles of that dominant understanding, practice and opinio iuris. But then you yourself in your PhD, you recognize that the ICJ itself was never really, keen in following that understanding of customary international law. And one major issue I have with the substance of your work is that when you present the dominant understanding, you present the case law of the court, you don't stop there and tell us, no, but the court itself has abandoned that doctrine. And the court maybe uses that doctrine sometimes when it is useful for it to go there, but the doctrine of the two elements is dead. For me, since the Gulf of Maine case that you have not enough exploited, it's a pity, because sometimes one major criticism I have with your work is that you give us quotations of case law and you let us guess ourselves what we should deduce from that, and what we should understand from that. You mentioned the Gulf of Maine case in your somewhere in your work, not to discuss the fact that the dominant understanding was killed by those who were maybe trying to have a dominant understanding, because in 1981 the court came and said, well, there are maybe rules of customary law that are based on practice and opinion iuris, but there are other rules of customary international law that are here because they are necessary to ensure vital cooperation and coexistence in the system. So the court itself created fragmentation within customary international law. And if you check the case law of the International Court of Justice since 1981, when the court discussed uti possidetis iuris, when the court discussed, you know, the customary nature of the principle of permanent sovereignty of the natural resources, etc., etc., the court never referred to that. So why we scholars keep on thinking that there is a dominant understanding? You are referring to diplomats earlier on in your response to my question. I'm sorry, I work with diplomats. I'm involved in many negotiations in many countries. When we discuss about something, whether something is customary law, I never witnessed any formalism in the discussion. I remember when we were having the negotiations regarding the Nile. We were negotiating an agreement on the Nile, a framework agreement on the Nile. And as you know, Egypt was very much opposed to the very idea that there is a so-called customary rule of international law, which would be called equitable and reasonable use of international water courses. Because Egypt believed that it has millenary rights over the Nile. But when the question popped up, there was no discussion of, you know, opinion iuris practice. No, the discussion was pragmatic. And this is why I want to go second substantive remark. Why, instead of talking about an argumentative framework, I think there is something you do not address in your PhD, in your work, is customary international law as pragmatism. Customary international law as a tool to reflect the contemporary concerns of the international community, period. You see what I mean? A tool to reflect the contemporary concerns of the international community. When the community is when there is strong concern about something in the community, custom is used to reflect those strong concerns. The need to protect the environment, the need to not to cause damage, the need to share rivers in an equitable manner, etc., etc. I think in your classification, there is one group that is missing. It's the group of pragmatics. Because he has believers, he has unbelievers, he has cynics. What about the pragmatists? I'm a pragmatic. Michael Wood is a pragmatic. Yeah. We believe that custom is here to ensure a social function, that when there is strong concerns within the community about a trend or something that has to be done, custom is there to give a legal closing to those strong concerns. And this, I think, would allow us to stop once for all this old debate about whether there is a dominant understanding. I don't really know who really knows international law and think that there is a dominant understanding. Yes, when we go to classes, when I teach international law, we need to start from something. So we tell our students, customs, the traditional doctrine is this. But then any honest professor of international law would tell the students, yeah, but in reality, custom is an enigma. And any honest professor of international law would show to his students that customary international law is subject to different content, different variation, different application when you are into investment law, into environmental law, into the law of treaties, into state responsibility, etc., etc. So I would like to hear you a bit later on the pragmatism issue, but allow me, if you allow me, just to continue on my substantive remarks. I think there is also another aspect that is missing in your work in terms of substance: judicial lawmaking. Lawmaking, custom as the product of lawmaking. We are in an era of judicialization, and international courts and tribunals have acquired so much importance, so much authority in the system. And sometimes, you know, custom would be a tool that they would use to assert authority or to fill maybe a legal vacuum in the system. I don't know, but custom as lawmaking, because you talked about deductivism, inductivism. I think there was also utopia, apology, and utopia. But I think there is a third way called lawmaking, and one missing element when I was reading your work was that all part of lawmaking in the process of formation of customary in international law, and I think this is something you will have to address. Now I will just finish my remarks with the last part of your work. I have more remarks, but I know I cannot keep the floor forever, which is a pity, because I wish we could stay here 5 hours. But I would like just to, but once again, because your PhD is so interesting, that's why. I would like to finish the work, my remarks, sorry, with the last part of your work, international environmental law. First of all, I think there's a problem with the title of your PhD. In your PhD, there are two theses, actually, in reality. There is a PhD on customary law, and then there is a PhD on international environmental law and how it relates to customary international law. And I think it's quite problematic in terms, once again, of substance and methodology, because you start talking about international environmental law as a laboratory for customary law at page 241, when we know that you have maybe 375 pages. Then it means that most of your work is not about analyzing, you know, how international environmental law could be a good laboratory to discuss those theories that you've been discussing before. So I think there is a problem of disbalance in the world. We shouldn't wait till page 241 to start discovering ideas about international environmental law. And because you chose to put the all environmental law at the very end, I think that the analysis is quite often superficial. There, I would say that this is the part of your PhD that I found really superficial. And once again, it's maybe because you didn't have time, or maybe it's because you were more interested in developing theories and so on about the argumentative framework and so on. But there are several weaknesses in the international environmental law part. It's too fast. It's too fast. When you discuss, for instance, the no harm rule, you do not really show us how this so-called rule of customary international law itself has been varying during time. You know, through the Trans-Smelter, Corfu Channel Principle 21. Of Stockholm, even Gapchikovo-Najimaros, because what the court says in Gapchikovo-Najimaros is not don't cause damage, it's respect the environment. The court is totally reformulating Principle 21. So you don't take time to show us how customary international law has evolved, the variation in the content, which would allow you actually to even better prove your theory, your theoretical framework. But also there are some mistakes. There are some mistakes. The Lake Lanao case, you use the Lake Lanao case as a confirmation of the customary nature of the no harm rule. I disagree. In the Lake Lanao case, the tribunal said, assuming that such a principle exists. So that tribunal was more cautious than Transmitter or the Corfu Channel's judgment, where they were very strong in that. I think we need to be careful. Sometimes my perception is that Fabian has an obsession of customary international law. You have an obsession of it. And because of that obsession, we see customary international, you tend to see customary international law everywhere. You have an old discussion about the shrimp turtles case as referring to customary international law. I'm sorry. I mean, shrimp turtles is not about customary law. It's about whether or not the United States of America has complied with subparagraph 20, subparagraph G of Article 20, and with the chapeau of Article 20. There's no discussion of customary international law there. But you make an old argument, you push for your argument about customary international law. So I think we need also to be careful not seeing something where it is not. It's important to be also reasonable with, you know, this description. And I will finish my intervention by two huge missing points in the environmental part. First of all, sustainable development. You don't discuss sustainable development. This is quite surprising or shocking, because today the international environmental law has become the law of sustainable development. And behind environmental concerns, you have the whole issue of sustainable development. And sustainable development has raised a lot of issues regarding with respect to its customary nature. There has been a lot of case law where there has been discussion on whether or not today international law requires to integrate appropriate environmental measures in the conception and implementation of economic development activities. So I would like to know why you do not discuss sustainable development when you discuss environmental law as a laboratory for customary law. And last but not least, the Kishanganga arbitration. India, Pakistan versus India, permanent court of arbitration. I think this is a very good case for you. I'm very surprised that you did not discuss it, because in that case, customary law was at stake. You know, the case was between Pakistan and India on the basis of the Indus Waters Treaty. And you have a paragraph in the Indus Waters Treaty, which is paragraph 29 of Annex G, which says that the tribunal, when it decides a dispute under the Indus Waters Treaty, has to apply the treaty, and to the necessary extent, but only to the necessary extent, customary international law. Pakistan came before the tribunal and said, you need to apply the precautionary principle, you need to apply environmental principles, because those principles reflect customary international law, and they have to apply even to activities or treaties that were concluded before the birth or emergence of environmental norms. And the tribunal there discussed the relationship between customary international law and treaty law in the field of environmental law. The tribunal said clearly that it would not take into account so-called customary rules of environmental law, because this would allow custom to supersede the treaty. And that those rules of customary law, they only have to be taken into account to the necessary extent. So I think it's really a pity that you did not have time maybe to explore all these aspects. But once again, I would like to finish there, to thank you again. It would be good if you could respond to some of my comments regarding sustainable development, pragmatism, at least in the international environmental field. But once again, thank you for your presentation, and thank you again very much to the university for the invitation.
Thank you so much. Should I respond right now? Okay, thank you so much, Professor McCann, for all your comments. As I said, I mean, I am writing down all what you are saying, and I find everything enriching. So where should I start? Should I start from the last remarks regarding the part of the analysis on customary international law? I think that you are right in saying that sustainable development is indeed, I mean, one of the main aspects of international environmental law. And of course, I couldn't disagree with that. I mean, you're completely right. Notwithstanding, what I had in mind at the time I was doing the manuscript, and at some point I thought that it would be more convenient whether I just focus the work particularly in the formation and the legal ascertainment process of customary international law in this regard, in customary international environmental law in particular, and not in the particular or specific principles or substantive primary principles sustaining the whole field. So I understand why always I could raise some expectations regarding international environmental law, because of course that's the field that I chose, not only because I like it, but because I think it's the perfect field where I could illustrate my argument. So from that perspective, I decided to focus rather in the formation, the ascertainment process of customary international law. When I allowed myself to quote some of the most well-known principles, I'm sorry I created such expectation, I didn't aim to develop the principles themselves. What I exclusively wanted to demonstrate is the fact that there is customary international environmental law, period. And I did this because of some mainstream doctrine that I referred to regarding the very existence of customary international environmental law. So at some point, I think we are even more closer than far away, because I related very much to your comments also in the morning when you pointed out the existence of this vacuum in international environmental law. So I was precisely behind finding like operational theoretical tools to understand, you know, the existence of such vacuum and the explanation, the implementation and the covering of the vacuum. So at some point I was thinking that I shouldn't probably develop the substantive content of international environmental law, and I agree I should, for the sake of the manuscript, eventually like precise that I don't pretend to go into international environmental law, but exclusively to illustrate the law ascertainment process of international environmental law in a theoretical level and not at the level of the substantive part. Although of course I am completely certain that such principles are tremendously important. That's also why the very same reason I didn't quote all the cases that have been sustaining international environmental law, although I of course have been taking note of the need to quote this case, but the methodological approach beforehand was to illustrate an argument on customary international law rather than developing a substantive theory of international environmental law, because actually I think that I wouldn't have the possibility to approach international environmental law substantively from my thesis, and I usually make such clarification that okay, it's a topic in which I am interested, of course, in my research agenda, but I try to stick in, for the sake of this very manuscript, exclusively to the discussion of the theory of customary international law. And this answers one previous question, why I didn't elaborate on the lawmaking of international environmental law. And it's also because of the same reason. That's the very reason why I didn't develop an argument on the, on the theory of the persistent objector, because I think those topics are more related to the issue of lawmaking of international law rather than the issue of the law ascertainment of international law, which is a different theoretical level in which I want to focus not my whole research, because I surely expect to develop this, but at least this particular manuscript to stay at the level of the law ascertainment of customary international law in a theoretical level.
Addressed by you.
Really?
So that reduces a lot my job, okay?
So, but I still have some points, and I think that I have some important and interesting points. The first thing, I don't like coming to form again, but I need to emphasize the problem with the titles. Repeated references and transcriptions. I got the feeling that you had to transcribe something, and then you didn't have the time to make a cross reference, and then you transcribed it again, and then again, and after a third, it gets a little bit tiring. Some specific references are lacking. Whenever you make a very important statement, and you attribute this statement to another person, you need to make a reference. And for instance, in page 130, okay? I understood why you kept on referring to Article 38 of the Statute of the Permanent Court of International Justice. But at a certain point it didn't work. Because at a certain point it was clear that you were referring to the Statute of the International Court of Justice and not to the Permanent Court of Justice. So I don't think that's a very good strategy. There was confusion, the spelling of the name of some authors, and yeah, this. My general remark about your thesis is this. It's a very important piece of work because it made me think a lot. And because it was clear, it reflected that you really dedicate your time to, you know, to not only read as much as you could. I'm not going to repeat the point about the methodology of choosing authors. I think that the main authors are there, and I think that you brought to yourself a very, very hard task, which is to try to put all these authors together and make sense of it in a uniform theory, in a unified theory. And only for you to bring this task upon you, I think you already deserve a lot of commend. You know, I really appreciate that. And I think that you succeeded in to a very great part. But to a certain extent, I think your theory is not as concluded as you might think that it is concluded. So my first point is, if I can, I interact with
yes.
you? My first point is, what is lacking in your theory? Well, from now on, what do you think is lacking in your theory? What are the weaker points of your theory?
Okay, should I respond?
Right yes.
Now? So thank you so much, Professor Ajoubi. I think there are many things lacking in my theory because as a general thing, I think it could be like a whole life research project. However, when I first came to this topic, to the topic of customary international law and gathering, like at the beginning, I am answering also one of the questions. I tried to look upon all the articles and books written on the field of customary international law. But at some point I realized that was almost an impossible. If you ask me, again, I am developing the answer. What is missing? I would love to develop a subsequent manuscript and research in which I describe this argumentative framework. I mean, my thesis simply shows that there is a need to understand and to comprehend customary international law as an argumentative framework, but it doesn't develop how is particularly and specifically this argumentative framework comprised of. At the beginning, I thought it would be great to have it, but then I realized that the task was also impossible for the sake of one research. So I decided to leave my thesis in this proposition of the need to change the paradigm and to say that there is the twilight of the traditional perspective to customary international and to promote a new perspective without, of course, depicting it particularly. I would love to do that indeed in a following research.
Okay, but do you think you changed the paradigm?
Pardon, I didn't.
Do you think you really changed the paradigm? Or do you think you can your theory, your whole theory, can be simply matched in one of the groups that you identify?
I think I really changed the paradigm. I mean, I believe that there is more work to be done in order to cause like a global impact from this perspective, because I am basically saying things which are contrary to what has been constantly said as regards customary international law. But if you ask me, I think that the fact of acknowledging, identify the
unbearable flaws of the traditional theory and presenting this social approach as a more honest and more transparent theoretical description of what is going on in practice, I think it really changed a mindset, because you are not longer approaching customary international law, at least from the traditional training that an earlier generation of international lawyers received, such as the distinction of this between primary and secondary rules. This is another point in which Professor Dacremon and I actually disagree, but just to complement the previous question. But I believe that this past generation, which was trained with this doctrine, in which you believe that the whole system is comprised of rules, and for a primary rule there is always a secondary rule, and for a secondary rule there is always a previous secondary rule, and eventually a rule of recognition. This mindset can be seriously challenged when you approach customary international law differently.
So this is of work in this field. You are telling me that your thesis is the product of 5 years changed the approach to the whole idea of customary international. Is this that you're telling me?
I think that this is another related answer. I think there is a dominant theoretical understanding.
No, it's not that my
question. So from that perspective,
My question is, you are saying that your thesis on which you work, for instance, you say that Verdross is really caught my attention. You said that,
excuse me, which page?
Page 66, Dreamers. Law as a consequence of the inner desires of the heart. And following that, you put Verdross in this group. So are you saying that Verdross really thought that the law that he was producing was the consequence of the inner desires of his heart? You're telling me that Verdross was one of the most recognized scientists in international law, could not distinguish between the inner desires of his heart and the work that he was producing. And on page 98, footnote 8, you refer to the New Haven School. I don't like the New Haven School, and I don't think that many people like the New Haven. Rationalists are still present today after so many years. And the reason is that maybe you should not get rid of them just like that. There is a reason why the International Law Commission is referring to customary law as a two-element approach. It's adopting a two-element approach to customary international law. And suddenly you change that to recite without really providing a substantial explanation for that. Okay? And I think this kind of issues decrease the value of your work. So I think my comment to you on this is maybe you should not try to reinvent the whole thing. Maybe you should try to add to the work of who came before, you know. Because this would have made your thesis something more tangible. And you would not have lost yourself in so many questions that were not necessary for you to address. When you address international customary environmental law. At a certain point, you said that you took to yourself the task of proving that it exists. Where is it? Let me show it.
issue in one of the sub-chapters of the final chapter, because of course there is a whole discussion between the regarding the difference between principles of international law and customary international law. So I developed a few pages in order to show that there are some discrepancies in the international legal doctrine regarding such difference. Whereas traditional perspectives, particularly influenced by the thought of Dworkin, of course, it differentiates principles and customary international law as two different international legal sources, which are featured by the particular characteristics that describe them as a source, whereas the rules have like precise and complete references to addressing behavior and addressing sort of behavior. Principles are more general statements that enlighten the international legal world. However, such traditional distinction of same principles as a general lighthouses of international law and rules as the actual and proper normative phenomenons that carry the normative burden, as regards international environmental law, the distinction has been challenged. Why? Because whereas international environmental law was built from principles, as you just said, in a famous arbitration like a trial, smelter arbitration, such principles have been applied and developed as if they were actual rules. For instance, I use and I think I quote the findings of Professor Cancelo Tridac in the opinion the Pope Mills case where he writes some piece about how international environmental law has managed to blur the line between rules and principles as they were like traditionally and strictly distinguished in the traditional theory of international law, but how in international environmental law principles are not only the lighthouses, but they can be the origin of actual influence in the behavior of their addresses. So of course there is I don't come to this discussion in large, because it's not what I aim to discuss, but what I refer is that the discussion does exist, that in terms of international environmental law the line has been blurred, and that principles are eventually treated as rules, even though traditional doctrine of course distinguish like completely
from
the two
of
them.
I agree with you, but you didn't answer my question. Because my question was not about the difference between principles and rules. And I know, yeah, there are lots of things about that. And important, we may not agree with it, but it's an important article because it brings a new way to look at certain things.
Okay.
What they say is this. This idea of custom without practice cannot sustain itself. However, if we look at this as the emergence of legal principles, then we may have room to say that this can't sustain, these rules or principles, they can't sustain. They can't sustain themselves as international legal principles, but not as customary international. But my question for you is, does it change the manner that you approach this topic on your thesis? Are you dealing with international legal principles, or are you really dealing with customary international law? Is it clear now?
Yeah, I mean, the use that I gave to that particular piece of work, of course, I am very aware of this very famous article on Jus Cogens, customary international law and principles. So the reason why I use this article is because, as influential as it is, it demonstrates how there has been a tendency to blur the line between all those different approachable issues regarding the sources of international law. Because, for instance, in that article, and it has been also very well criticized, it is proposed that human rights are just covens. And it is kind of weird that the criteria of just covens is put in the same level of two sources. So there are two sources, like principles, customary law, but in the same line of the title is included a category which is not concerned with a formal source, but rather with a hierarchical distinction of the sources. But from this perspective, I wanted to prove and to elaborate on how there has been how the line has been blurred regarding those different matters, and why in such cases still the ultimate criteria, even within the chaos and within the confusion, the final and ultimate criteria is given by the law ascertainment standards provided by customary international law. Because as far as I know, the yardsticks of the principles are not clear either, and jus cogens is not even a formal source, but a distinction of authority, of legal hierarchy. So I use this piece to illustrate that between those three criteria or concept is the one of customary international law, the one who finally it can provide with some parameters, with some yardsticks to ascertain international law. So that's why I use this piece, and sometimes I relate it to also the developments made by Cancel Trindade on that regard, and the blurring of the line between principles of rules and principles of customary international law. However, it wasn't my intention to, of course, to go in depth in the discussion, although I think, of course, Professor Endurbi, that you are right, that this is an important discussion. Notwithstanding at the time of the composition of the manuscript, and considering also the amount of information, I tried to any case, avoid discussions that were not like at the heart of the law ascertaining criteria of customary international law. Though I had to spend a few times to acknowledge that I was aware of the distinction between principles, rules, principles, customary law, and that there is an issue in the particular field of international environmental law to which I was not going to devote my ideas, at least in this present manuscript. But
the differentiation between law and non-law, you cannot simply, if there is a difference between international general principles of international law and customary international law, you cannot blur the lines between them. Especially because we're adopting an approach that several times goes to the theory of language and how you analyze language and how you wanna. So you need to be careful with this kind of distinctions. A little bit more careful with that. While you analyze your case study, you choose one specific community, which is the community of international environmental lawyers. But we fail to take into consideration the whole community of international lawyers. And many international lawyers outside of the community of international environmental lawyers think that what the international environmental lawyers are dealing with is not custom, something else. So, first, how do you apply your theory? Second, how do you choose the community of relevance in order to ascertain whether there exists a rule or not? And how do you define, how do you determine the community and choose the community everywhere? Why did you choose the international environmental law community, not the global community? You need, and this cannot be something that you simply choose. You need to come up with some criteria for that. And which are the criteria? Sometimes you seem to include non-lawyers, technicians and everything. I agree with you on that, but I want to understand the criteria that you use to include non-lawyers in the in the community. You talk about an argumentative campaign, and there are arguments that are successful in this argumentative campaign. How are the criteria to ascertain which arguments are successful? And why, above all, why should we prefer the community, the invisible community of international lawyers, of, instead of the community of states? Don't you see that there is, do you think that there might be a democratic problem there? Especially in regards to states that, let's not talk about the whole community, global community, but let's talk about the Western states and the Latin American states where there is a democracy. At least governments have the legitimacy to create law. And suddenly you are transferring this to a community of lawyers that involve lots of people who did not receive that mandate from their populations. What I'm trying to grasp here is try to move you forward a little bit on your research and try to show you some developments that on which you can dedicate afterwards. But please try to answer these questions.
Thank you so much. So, how do I apply the theory of the argumentative framework? I think that the initial, even though the initial endeavor of the manuscript is to develop a more honest and transparent perspective, theoretical description, conceptual description of customary international law, I think I would advise like people working in the field just to not to look at the traditional two-element doctrine of customary international law, particularly in the field of international environmental law, because I think that, as I had said, the rules would be to contaminate, to cause harm, to provide environmental damage, so to ignore the binary approach of the traditional theory of customary international law, because that is not working, is not going to be the trigger of any international environmental rule, in the case of course, international environmental rule, but to start in argumentative campaigns for international environmental rule. I mean, and I think that has happened. The thing is that it hadn't been theorized, because that's how the most important customary principles of international environmental law, such as those of the most important included, for instance, in the Rio Declaration, or the very important principle of sustainable development itself, they didn't develop out of practice and opinion juris. That never happened. What happened is that there were argumentative campaigns, usually triggered by the civil society, by the community of international lawyers, with the support of a few states and not all of them, and eventually with the support also of the academic community, some of them made it through. It's like, I think it's like a race, like you're going in a race, and argumentative race, argumentative campaigns, and eventually some of them made it through, and eventually they become acceptable ones, they are being used in the exercise of international law. So in that case, if I were in a meeting, for instance, of state advisors, let's say people coming from the developing world, very interested in the developing of customary international environmental law, I would say, okay, practice is not the criteria, because there is not gonna be like a consistent practice sustaining such rules. If we have a purpose, if we have a raison d'être, either in this case it would be an apology, and you know how I relate to all these concepts, you have to start developing campaigns, and in order to so that those customary principles might be eventually acceptable. Of course, in accordance with the limited that I presented in my initial speech. You have to do it through the technical language of international law, through the institutions and through people who are well positioned in some areas of international environmental law. And that's why I have been mentioning a few people who have been like determinant for the acceptance of some principle. So that's what I would have said to a group of people, like sharing how to discuss newly customary international law. Besides, of course, and I mentioned this as well, if you take the traditional approach, you will be locked by the paradox of customary international law, because this traditional approach doesn't describe the possibility of having new customary law, because you always have to have this practice already having in mind that such practice had been mandatory, legally mandatory. So the traditional approach is not going to work for the development of new customary international law. Eventually, it works for the explanation of existing customary international law. So in this particular field of the environment, I think that if we gather the lawyers and we say, come on, let's start a campaign for the development of
member to speak, but before starting I have to say that I have really read the first version of this work during the pre-reading session with some members of our Research Center of International Law and with some other doctorate candidates, and I found that you have made important changes to this in this final version. You have taken into consideration our major suggestions, and the result is definitely much better than this first one presented. However, I still have some suggestions and some objections that I will divide in a very classic way. I will start speaking about formal aspects and then substantive issues. So about the formal aspects, your dissertation is divided into two well-equilibrated parts, each one with two chapters. You have written four chapters that can be read independently. And this could be very interesting if you are willing to submit it to four different publications. However, the main issue when reading them in one single piece is, as already has been said by Professor Mbenge, you repeat a lot of information, and it's difficult to follow your theory. The questions are presented in a clear fashion. It is well written, even if there are some typographical errors. And you still have a lot of problems with many cross-references at footnotes. I will just mention four examples, but there are much more. At note 117, page 50, there's a wrong cross-reference, and it's exactly the same case at note 123, page 53, note 128, page 54, note 160, page 64, etc.
I should respond to the first comment, which is common in all the three members of the jury. In that regard, I just can simply apologize, because I really realize that some editorial corrections need to be done at some point. Of course, I've been making a tremendous effort between a very tight schedule, although of course that's not an excuse at all for having such kind of errors. There were at some point I did a very quick check, like for the past month after we had the seminar at the doctorate program with all the other professors and members of the program. But yeah, apparently I failed to check every single thing. So I am aware and I receive that comment on that regarding the need to fix all the editorial matters and some cross references and these kind of things. So this is something I am very aware of. I apologize to the jury for that, but it's something I will, no matter the outcome of this session, I will certainly do it, and I've been doing it. I am aware of that, and again, I can't say anything against that, but only to thank you for letting me know that these kind of things needs to be done. So, and I will do them. So that's simply what I can say about this. Regarding the eclectic register, language register of the manuscript, that was done in purpose actually. I find the way that classic English scholars write about legal theory and how they sometimes develop like very heavy theoretical arguments, and in order to burden the reader to keep out the burden and to lighten a bit the discourse, how they use like practical examples, even colloquial illustrations, just to illustrate the point. So I did this in purpose, because I wanted the reader to follow what I was trying to say, and I wanted to reach a more number of readers as well at some point. So what I simply wanted to do is to make it more clear, you know, some arguments that they were heavy itself, as we all have said, the bulky documents and the heaviness sometimes of the arguments. So I thought that could facilitate the reading of the material. And regarding the genesis, I exceptionally do that when I simply want to refer to the state of art of some developments. In this case, I was not like making specific comments on the records of the preparatory works of the commission, but I wanted to recall what was done there, and I choose one of the most complete works which had already organized such information. So as my argument was going to the legal ascertainment of the source, in this part I want to review what had been done in within the commission. So I thought it was enough if I showed that there was a person who had already done this task, because in this case I was not evaluating or assessing the information, but building the story, reviewing what had historically happened in that session. But it was like a historical construction and not the construction of the argument itself. So in that case, in such kind of cases, I occasionally use just a work you have already dealt with such kind of topic, like being aware that was not the purpose of my discussion itself. So I simply said, okay, I don't need to develop on this because this person has already done it. So I don't need to reinvent what other had already said in this regard. Yeah, so that was the choice, but it's not the approach in all the areas, but it's an exceptional approach.
Yes,
when I am building historical.
The first one is that in the introduction, you announce the methodology you will use, but you do not refer to the specific methods you will use. I have identified, reading your dissertation, a predominant method, obviously, in the theory of law, but I have also identified many uses of sociological method, juridical technique, and philosophy of law. And I would like, I think it would have been useful to mention them and the use of these methods in the introduction, and especially to explain why you have selected them. And my second remark regarding this methodology part of your introduction is more a question. Why have you decided to restrict the language of your doctrinal sources to English ones, and deliberately, and I quote you, with a very exceptional use of documents written in Spanish? My question is quite natural because you're a native Spanish speaker, and I don't think there is a lot of theory of international law written in Spanish, so why have you decided to restrict it to English sources?
Okay, information in Spanish, but most of the information have been essentially reviews of the most classic reconstructions of the theory of customary international law. So actually I was having the perspective that you of course rightly suggest me regarding why I'm using Alain Pellet or other authors to reveal something that has been already said. So it's because of the same perspective. I found that some of the very few Spanish references to the theory of customary international law consists in the review of Anglo-Saxon literature or classic French literature, which has been also dealt by Anglo-Saxon literature. So I said, why don't we go to the original source if Spanish literature is being written in being just quoting English literature, let's go to the direct source and discuss the English literature, which has been very influential. The other reason, of course, is why, for instance, I didn't go into the French literature, essentially, is because I don't speak French. I didn't go through the whole analysis of the French literature also by some. I found some of the most influential references, exceptionally eventually when they had been used within the framework of Anglo-Saxon literature. However, locally and locally, which has been very convenient at this stage of our generation of international lawyers, most of the literature, even coming from French-speaking.
Interesting. Talking about if there is any customary international environmental law, you're citing and using five or six examples of principles of international environmental law as customary international environmental law. Because the ICJ says it, and some scholars endorse this approach, and because some international treaties codified it in soft law instruments. So if this is true, I would like to know if you consider them really customary international law or just some principles of international law, a sort of soft law not really contributing to customary international law, but to the future emergence of customary international environmental law. I mean, you're not demonstrating that those principles are really customary international environmental law. You're just confronting them to a reference definition or to a dominant understanding without any conclusions in this regard. We have some answers further in chapter 4 regarding, you know, the no harm principle and the precautionary principle. But I have a feeling of incompleteness regarding the other side at the beginning of the chapter.
Okay. Quote, the strong support that they have in the community in order to be considered and be treated as customary international law. So although I don't carry out the evaluation for the other principles, I present those principles in any case, no matter if I don't carry out the assessment here in the manuscript, they are treated and considered and applied as if they were customary international environmental law. And those principles, although...
With your answer, you made me to come back, and I'm sorry for this, to a question already mentioned by Professor Drouby. And it is because I'm not totally convinced by your analysis between the difference about the difference of the source of international law and the product of the source of international law. When you differentiate between custom as a source and custom as a rule in the first chapters, it seems clear. But it becomes confused in the last chapter, in chapter 4, when we remind this tension and talk about the difference between principles and rules. I'm sorry, but I'm definitely not convinced by your answer. So could you please elaborate further on this matter? Yes,
or
between
rules
and principles.
And principles. Uh-huh. Regarding that distinction.
And the source and the product of the source. Two distinctions that I think you're confusing in your dissertation.
Okay, so regarding that distinction, of course, I agree that the distinction becomes confusing in the field of international environmental law. So it is actually the purpose of the manuscript to show that such confusion that is not well evident in the general theory of customary international law, but that it becomes evident in international environmental law. So it is indeed my purpose to show the reader that there is such confusion in this particular field. Why? because although international environmental law has been sustained on the shoulders of principles, mainly and originally generated by civil society and with the and scholars and the support of some states, they were originally formulated as principles in nature. However, when the time comes that those principles were applied within adjudicative scenarios, and I am not meaning that international law is exclusively can be seen in adjudicative scenarios, but this is where international law sometimes becomes more palpable. So when they come to be applied in adjudicative scenarios like the International Court of Justice or the dispute settlement body of the WTO, they are applied after being considered customary international law. And that's, for instance, the reason why in the hormones case, the appellate body didn't consider important to develop whether the precautionary principle was or was not customary international law. And I actually mentioned that quote. So even though they said, okay, we are not going to deal with this, but only by the very fact of saying that they were not dealing with the customary nature of the precautionary principle, they were treating the principle as it should be treated as a customary rule. And that's the same approach like given by the ICJ in the application of some environmental principles. They when they come to be applied and when they come to be used in order to have like binding decisions, they are treated as if they were customary international law, despite of the fact that such distinction, of course, we are all aware of it, is being made in the general theory of the sources of international law. So what I essentially, my purpose is indeed to show that there is such big confusion and big mess in this field in particular, in the field of the environment.
Okay, thank you. When you explain it, it seems less confusing, so maybe you can clarify it a little bit better in your dissertation. I have another question. If customary international environmental law is an argumentative framework where voluntarism is absent, so it is consent, which is surpassed by consensus, as you say, where a deductive method is privileged and there is a big part of utopian approaches, my question is, will it be possible to consider the legitimacy of the persistent objector regarding, for instance, the precautionary principle or the no harm principle? I know that you have previously said that you haven't mentioned the persistent objector in your dissertation, but the question came naturally to my mind when you said, when you erased totally consent from your argumentative framework.
Okay, you mentioned it. You
thank
mentioned
you very
persistent
much.
Persistent objective. There
yeah,
are two
thank
pages
you.
Where you talk
I,
about it.
Yes, at some point, I thought that. Your concern could be very relevant in the argument. So at some point when I was developing the argumentative framework of customary international environmental law, I finally, after the suggestion in the past seminar, which I found very reasonable, I added a couple of paragraphs in which I mentioned why I don't develop the argument on the persistent objector. And this is the reason. I think that the doctrine of the persistent objector goes into a discussion located at a different level, at the level of the lawmaking of international law. Whereas I've been always emphasizing that the aim of my research was to discuss the level of the law ascertainment of international law. However, I make also a distinction with a similar situation which might be interpreted as being a persistent objector, and is when in the construction process of this argumentative framework, a very influential member of the community of international lawyers opposed the rule. As it had happened, for instance, with the United States and the precautionary principle. Although I don't eventually the opposition of influential members could hinder or slow the process, the formation process of customary international law. However, I emphasize that the whole doctrine of the persistent objector, which is of course a very developed discussion in the theory of customary international law, goes more directly to the making of international law and not the ascertainment of international law. So I agree with you. I find your suggestion absolutely relevant, and that's why after the discussion we had at the doctorate program, I of course did add the clarification, because it really needed to be clarified.
Okay, thank you.
So thank you.
I'm pretty convinced that the evaluation of the young and fresh Latin American community of scholars. So if there are no more questions from the members of the board, I hereby close this meeting of doctoral examination for further deliberations, and may I kindly ask the candidate and the public to leave the room for a few minutes for deliberation. So I will finally resume the public audience and proceed to read the final act containing the decision, and with the permission of our director, I would like to give a few words in Spanish for audience family. We, the members of the doctorate thesis jury, Sufian Drubi, Makane Moiz-Mbenge, and Carolina Olarte-Vacares, having met in private session in order to discuss the doctorate research and presentation made by Fabian Augusto Cardenas Castañeda, in accordance with the institutional rules of Pontificia Universidad Javeriana and the doctorate program in juridical science, and considering, one, the quality of the manuscript, it is substantial despite some lack of clarity and typographical errors, two, ability of the doctoral student to contextualize, a good ability to contextualize, but with a tendency to repeat, three, quality of the presentation, the work has been presented in a clear and understandable manner, four, contribution to the juridical science. It contributes to the advancement of knowledge within international law, but he has to improve the international environmental law contributions. And taking into account articles 105, 108, 109 of the rules of the doctorate program in juridical science, decides a final grade outstanding. And we suggest a summa cum laude distinction. Basadas en la calidad del manuscrito, la habilidad del estudiante para contextualizar, la calidad de su presentación y la contribución de su estudio a la ciencia jurídica, y tomando en cuenta los artículos 105, 108, 109 de las reglas del programa de doctorado en ciencias jurídicas, decido otorgarle el grado sobresaliente al trabajo presentado y propone una mención summa cum laude para su trabajo.
Welcome to the club.
Thank you so much.
And we're looking forward to having a great colleague.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hello.
Welcome to the Invisible College, my friend.
Thank you so much.
Muchas felicitaciones. Muchas gracias por la invitación. Hoy nos merecemos algo para celebrar.